production of Broad and High is funded in part by the Greater Columbus Arts Council, supporting arts, advancing culture, and connecting the community to artists, events, and classes at columbusmakesart.com.
PNC, committed to Central Ohio, for the achiever in you. From these contributing sponsors and viewers like you, thank you.
This time on Broad and High. Meet a local graffiti artist who describes his work as ghetto hieroglyphics. We visit an OSU student as she prepares new work for her MFA thesis.
Lately, I've been really just thinking about color intention.
And new music by Columbus band Honey and Blue. This and more right now on Broad and High. Hi everyone, welcome to Broad and High. I'm your host, Kate Quickle. Our first story tonight takes us to the Harrison West neighborhood of Columbus. That's where we find graffiti artist Adam Hernandez. He describes his work as ghetto hieroglyphics and hopes his illustrations contribute to the mythological landscape of public art.
I was born and raised in the Bronx, New York. I moved to Columbus about 10 years ago. I'd like to describe my artwork as like ghetto hieroglyphics is the term that I've dubbed it. In my kind of philosophy is that graffiti and ancient hieroglyphics are kind of one and the same. So I incorporate elements of both, even though they're very stylistically different. I try to meld the two styles. I like to go out and use spray paint out on like abandoned places and stuff like that. I think that's really cool. I also like to make stickers out of like recycled like vinyl material. People throw out old like sticker scraps, and I like to paint on top of that and make my own stickers. I like to block print. I incorporate a lot of herons and cranes and in a lot of different mythologies. Herons and cranes are like kind of symbols of like connectors between this world and like the world beyond. I also incorporate the thunderbird a lot. It's kind of the thing that I'm known for. And like thunderbirds are like really sweet, like Pacific Northwest Native American tribes incorporate the thunderbird a lot. And they're kind of like messengers from the gods. And they're like symbols of like power and something like for myself personally, for a long time, I wasn't the most self-confident person. So I've kind of taken the idea of the thunderbird, this really powerful, majestic beast, as a bit of a mascot, as something that I strive to be. So I kind of, as an artist, wanted to create my own mythology, but still reference the things that universally we all can relate to. We're distracted a lot by like social media. Like we live in kind of a trying time right now. I think there's a lot of lessons we can learn from like ancient myth and stuff. People were kind of dumb. We do the same things over and over again. Hopefully soon here we'll learn our lesson and love each other a little more.
Follow along with all of Adam's latest art projects on Instagram. You can find him at ahernandezart. Now we want to introduce you to Maija Miettinen. She was born in Helsinki, Finland, and recently earned her MFA here in Columbus at Ohio State University. She thinks often about the interconnectedness found in the world and its ability to shift perceptions, and it's evident in her latest body of work, which is composed of repetitive optical patterns that challenge the notion of open versus closed spaces. She recently welcomed us into her studio to document her creative process.
My grandmother had a good friend who was a painter, and so my grandmother commissioned her to do my portrait. This one summer, I would travel to her house and sit for her several times, and I was 12, and she was like 82 at the time. I was just totally fascinated by the process of what she was doing, and we had these long conversations about art, and she was telling me about her life in Paris, where she was in the 50s, spent most of her life there. And that was the first time I sort of understood what maybe it is to be an artist. And I remember sitting there and watching her paint and listening to that sound of painting, that like scratching kind of sound, and her mixing the colors and the sort of slow process of it. So that was very significant, and I think that was sort of the seed for the future. The work that I'm doing right now, it's for my thesis show, which means that I'll be graduating from the MFA program. And so I'm making 5 paintings that are all 5 feet by 6 feet on canvas, using spray paint, enamel paint, and oil and acrylic. I think about my paintings for a long time before I make them. Like the paintings that I'm doing right now, I've been thinking about them the past, 8 months, 9 months. You know, the color, the scale, all the different aspects of them. And then when I start working, I try not to think about anything but just the making. It like in dance, like you dance, you practice, but then when you perform, you don't think about the choreography anymore. You just have to, it's in your muscle memory. You just go to it and your body guides you. Lately, I've been really just thinking about color intention and the subtleties, I guess, of that. I work on layers. I'm very specific layers of like the underpainting, then the next layer, and then the next layer. And I'm trying to find some sort of place where they are palpable or resonating between those different layers, where one is not more dominant than the other.
Well, the stencils I first started to use was the circle. I wanted to make a perfect circle and sort of remove my hand or some kind of idea of like making a circle, like with some sort of device. But then I became really interested in the space between those circles, and that's where this shape came from. And then I wanted to try to figure out like how can I use that shape, so I thought, well, I can use it as a stencil. It's a very interesting form. It's open and it's closed, and with the line, it can be either infinite, it can continue infinitely, or if you turn it to like attach those two ends of the line, it makes a circle too. Mm-hmm. So it's sort of, there's a paradox, like they're totally different kinds of forms, but they're also the same form at the same time. They sort of conceal within that is the same form. So that's why I also think it's really interesting.
Thank you.
if I can get this done, it'll be a good thing. Good day. Finish a painting. Getting there.
Everything else is so instant, like instantaneously, you know, posting things, doing things constantly really quickly, but painting you have to slow down. And that's something, you know, really different. And you have to confront the work itself and yourself in many ways. Like, I mean, I can sometimes work 15 hours and, you know, that kind of intensity, but slowness, and there's no shortcuts. I mean, I find painting such as so fascinating because there are these objects, there are two-dimensional, but they're three-dimensional at the same time. They're so little in a sense. I mean, it's just paint and canvas, but the kind of things they do, I think there is a bodily responses that they evoke. Like, I can look at a painting and I see some paint, and it makes me want to, like, taste it or touch it, or like, what is that thing, and how they can command you in the space in such a way and have this presence. I'm fascinated by the mystery of them.
Someone once described Stephanie Amber's singing voice as honey ice cream on a hot summer day. Paired with the soulful and bluesy guitar sounds from Adam Darling, the Columbus band's name was born. Together, they are Honey and Blue, and they're the latest musical act to join us in the WOSU studio to perform a track off their latest album, All the Feels.
You came in through the window, 'cause I boarded up the doors, and I didn't wanna love you, but I didn't have a choice. Was a mess, I confess. I thought I knew what was best. Such a poet throwing walls up, hiding feelings in my chest. You know you put up quite a fight. I pulled away, but you held tight. You held tight. You came in through the window, 'cause I bought it up the door.
Feet can barely touch the ground. I'm grateful that the walls came down, came down. So happy we were ever now.
Change my mind. did it touch the ground. I'm grateful that your walls came down.
Be sure to check out the band's latest music and concert schedule at honeyandblue.com. Finally tonight, a visit to Yellow Springs. That's where we meet sculptor John Barlow Hudson, who creates public art on a monumental scale.
My professional label would be public sculptor, and I've wanted to do that for a long time because you reach more people by making work for public places. Of course, I just started out making small sculptures. That was great fun, but it's like a dollhouse. It's all fine to make a dollhouse, but that's for dolls. You need to make a big, real house in order to use it, to live in it. So, same with sculpture. A little sculpture is fine for a maquette or sitting on a table, but to experience it with your whole being, you need it to be of a scale that you can relate to it with, climb on it or bump into it. I've got public sculptures throughout the states, from Maine to California. I have public sculptures in 27 different countries, and there are at least 22 throughout China. Each different project has a different geography, environment, plants, architecture, function. So maybe in one context, stone would be most appropriate, or stainless steel, or like downtown Dayton, the yellow piece, that's powder-coated aluminum. That street used to be a canal full of water, used to transport, create energy, and so on. So today the street is a canal for vehicles, which create eddies in the air as they race by. So fluid dynamics seemed the appropriate concept for that location. Paradigm Shift is a mirror stainless steel piece. Moore Technology Center at Sinclair is teaching new technologies. And so we are in a paradigm shift from the mechanistic to the informational or electronic age. So that piece vortexes up one direction and midway changes and vortexes the opposite direction. Sometimes, depending on the piece, I like to surprise people. Like if you take the bronze tree of books at our Yellow Springs Public Library, I started out with this stack of books and made this spiral trunk, and then they spin off the top. And then within the tree, I put what were then contemporary things like a cassette recorder and cassette tapes and audiovisual tapes. And I also made a bookworm climbing through a book. And then there's a book with the title of my mother's published novel. Those are elements to discover. It's that discovery that's really fun. Public projects tend to take a lot of time, in particular because you've got committees and regulations and all that stuff, and you put a whole package together. It ends up being 6 months or a year or 2 years or some such thing. Let's go to the common good, for example. I spent a good 2 years on that project, and that wasn't that big. I had the stone, a very large granite service plate from Wright Pat Air Force Base. I got it for the cost of getting it over here. And it sat for almost 20 years, I think.
Well, that's pretty good.
I waited until this opportunity came that I could give it a home. The impetus for the Common Good sculpture was Tim Reardon, the city manager for Dayton, also Cincinnati. And after he retired, Tim got to thinking that he wanted to honor the public servants that he had worked with over his career. As a committee, we came up with the idea of a bunch of quotes, and we decided to run the quotes around the stone so that you have to walk around the stone to read it so as to engage the viewer. And then the seats, of course, engage you. There's quotes inside, and then you see that you can sit in it. And because there's an interconnecting hole, you can talk through the stone, which is the idea of communicating, breaking through walls. In public service, it's all about communication and coming together. It's not an environmental sculpture. It's more about communicating an idea to the people in the community.
My name is Tim Reardon, and this is a project I've worked on for a couple years. The name of the piece is The Common Good. We had a lot of discussion about what we should name the piece, and it really just felt, this is what we work for, this is what we do. We do the common good. And I want to start it out just by saying a thank you to all the public servants who do such good work for our city, schools, county, state, and country, and the world. And I just think it's a great deal.
Why is public art important? I think it's important because it's a way of embodying energies of that time, which is then communicated with people down through time. So, you know, you have the Roman period and the Greeks or the Egyptians, all these different energies of that time we get to see because of the sculpture and the creative works that were made. It enriches our experience of being human, our history in the world. It shows how our culture got to be what it is. And those people are communicating with us today. And I want to do that with my work. So that's why I like to build big sculpture.
That's our show. You can find all our stories online at WOSU.org. And of course, give us a follow on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. We're leaving you today with more local music by Honey and Blue. For all of us here at WOSU, I'm Kate Quickle. Thanks for watching. We'll see you back here next week with more great stories of Columbus creativity. I'm strong, I'm tough. I can't do this anymore.
I got pulled aside when I was younger to be a therapist at school for other kids. So they wanted me to be a student counselor, and I was dealing with my own stuff and I didn't think I could help other people, but they really believed I could help other people. So that is a good reason why I paint, is to deal with my own stuff. And like, as long as my hands are busy, everything is a lot easier to deal with because I'm making progress in some way. Like, every painting is basically a short-term goal achieved. A lot of people know that I do freestyle painting, or I just make things up as I go along, and I don't know basically what the end product is going to be. But I'm also an illustrator, and I love comic books, and I love cartoons. And I love music, and so anything that makes me happy and spurs me to paint, I do it.
Catch Columbus at its creative best on Broad and High, Thursday nights at 8 o'clock on WOSU-TV.
Production of Broad and High is funded in part by the Greater Columbus Arts Council, supporting arts, advancing culture, and connecting the community to artists, events, and classes at columbusmakesart.com.
PNC, committed to Central Ohio, for the achiever in you. From these contributing sponsors and viewers like you, thank you.